Hi, welcome. It's good to see everybody back out this afternoon. The only few announcements we have, I guess, would be if you're able to, come back Wednesday night as Brian continues in the study of Kings. And then Thursday morning again at 10:30 a.m. for the adult Bible study. There's a pretty long list on the prayer list. I guess I don't say the most important, but I guess one that's really highlighted this morning would be still continuing to pray for Sandra and Jackie as she goes through some health concerns. But there's a bunch. Again, there's a whole bunch. I'm not going to read them all, but there's a lot of people on this list. If you don't have a copy of a bulletin, just grab a copy, and we'll pray for those tonight and throughout the week. Jody's still in Belize. Upcoming events will be, February 5th, we'll have a congregational meeting. That'll be the first Sunday. So immediately after the service, we'll have a congregational meeting to go over the budget. And that's about the closest thing, I think, coming up. So if you will, let's go to God in prayer tonight. All right, dear God, thank you for the day you've given us and for blessing us and for just all you do for us, Lord, and how you watch out for us. And Lord, we're thankful for today to be able to come here today and tonight and study your word and worship you. Lord, as we continue tonight, we lift prayers up to those on the prayer list and those folks traveling. And Lord, we pray that you'll bless them, keep them safe, and be with the families of those sick and those folks who are sick. And Lord, as we continue tonight, we pray everything we do is in accordance with your will. And Lord, be with Brian as he delivers the message that we're able to take that and apply it to our lives and go out and share it with others. And dear God, forgive us for our sins tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
You would turn up into 97. To 937. I don't think we've sang this in a long time. Is this the one we normally sing? I was looking at that chorus there. What do we normally sing, the chorus? Anybody got any thoughts? You don't think it is, Vance?
I don't know.
I tell you what, let's turn to 957. 957. I really had that one down. Anyway, 957. This sort of goes with Brian's lesson from Wednesday night. When the Savior calls, I will answer. When he calls for me, I will hear. When the Savior calls, I will answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Song will be number 572, if you mark that, 572.
Good to see a good number out this evening. I'm glad you were able to be here and join us. Let me say here at the outset a couple of things. Number one, I know we've been dealing with a little bit of an echo. Sorry about that. I don't know what caused it necessarily, but we're trying to fix it. So, again, I apologize if you're listening online, and I know some of us even heard it in the auditorium. We're trying to correct that. Not sure what happened, but we'll continue to effort to find a resolution to that. So, say that, number one. We do know about it. It's just a matter of fixing it. Number two, just a reminder, next Sunday evening, our brother Patrick is going to begin a series of classes. We'll have a short devotional, but he'll have a class for the next few weeks, except for the first Sunday, but we'll skip that one. But then everyone, we have a normal 5 o'clock service. He's going to have a class on singing and learning about music and singing in our worship to kind of help us better understand how to sing. So I encourage everyone to be here. I know we'll learn and grow from that. As a part of that, because we want to do it more of a hands-on kind of class, it won't be broadcast on Facebook. So in order to enjoy that, you need to be here. So just a reminder about those couple of things. As I mentioned this morning, we began a series here, a short series, a study on the end times and looking at the coming, second coming of Christ and of Judgment Day. And so this morning we looked more at the second coming and when that was going to occur and some important things to remember as children of God and even for those outside of Christ, we need to focus our attention on. He's coming back, and so we need to be prepared. This evening, I want to look at the judgment day again, but more specifically at that day itself, and look at what Scripture has to say about what that day will be like. Now, at the outset, there's a lot of symbolic language used in regard to Judgment Day. And so we have to allow some symbolic license to Scripture where it's warranted. Like in the book of Revelation, he uses a lot of symbols. We need to understand symbols are used to denote a meaning, but they may not be or should not be taken literal. As in the seven-headed dragon. Well, he's not talking about seven-headed dragon. He's talking about Satan. And he's using some poetic license to describe attributes of Satan. Well, the same is true in Judgment Day. And we'll look at that in just a few minutes. But we looked at this passage in Acts chapter 1 this morning. As the apostles were standing there, and they were watching Jesus being taken up out of their midst, and they're wondering, when is his return going to be? The angel said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way you saw him go into heaven." And so, of course, the angel is pointing to that time in the future that the angel himself didn't even know. But a time in the future when Jesus would make his triumphal return to here, to this world, to collect his people. John chapter 14, what does Jesus say? He says, "I do not want you to..." He's talking about the apostles and their need to not be sorrowful. He says in John 14, beginning at verse 1, if I can turn over there. He says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms." Older translations have the word mansions, but the idea of there's a place there for you, a place reserved. "If it were not so, I would have told you. That I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. And I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." And so there's that promise that Jesus provides to the apostles and to us as well, that Jesus will come again. Now, again, we mentioned this morning, we don't know when that's going to be. Even Jesus himself confessed that he did not even know, that it was not even information that had been provided to him. And so, again, it's very arrogant for any of us to claim knowledge of something even Jesus didn't have. I think that's pretty astounding to make any kind of statement that I know when time's going to end. Why? How? I mean, Jesus didn't know, and I think I can figure it out. So we know that and understand it. So looking at that day, what will take place on Judgment Day? What will that day look like? I'm going to spend a few minutes this afternoon looking at that from a scriptural standpoint. What will the day look like? Number one, it will come suddenly. I want to emphasize that here at the beginning because I think we need to remember that. We need to take that in because, again, what's the admonition that Peter gives and that Paul gives? Because it's going to come suddenly, we need to be prepared. Again, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we looked at it this morning. What does he say? He says, "The Lord will come as a thief in the night," verse 2. And then in verse 3, he says, "Destruction will come on them suddenly." And it's going to be a momentary moment when Jesus will return, when he will appear in the clouds, and it'll be at a time that we do not expect. And so this idea of suddenness, Jesus himself paints this picture for us in Matthew 24. Matthew 24, verse 40 says, That is the way it will be when the Son of Man comes. So he's talking about his second coming. Two men will be working together in the field. One will be taken, the other will be left. Two women will be grinding flour at the mill. One will be taken, the other left. So you too must keep watch or be alert, for you do not know what day that will be. And so that impact of the idea of the suddenness of it, that it will come in a moment we do not expect. And so as Christians, we need to be expecting every moment. We need to be on alert every moment to be prepared. So he will come suddenly. Number two, when he comes, Jesus will be revealed in the sight of all creation. Now, why is that important? Well, some teach falsely the idea that there's going to be a second first coming. That Jesus, when he comes again, will come one time secretly, and then one time it'll be exposed to all. Was that the picture the Bible paints? Does it paint this idea of some kind of invisible coming of Jesus? Well, let's let the Bible speak. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Paul again here speaking to our brothers and sisters in Thessalonica. And he says, I do not want you to be unaware or uninformed or ignorant, brethren, about those who are asleep, about those who've passed on, those who've died, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with them those who have fallen asleep. Now, you can imagine if you're living in the first century, now we're way past that and we don't live in that world, but they had just recently heard about Jesus. They had recently, the whole church had begun just a couple decades ago. And the apostles, even in Acts chapter 2, were expecting Jesus any moment, because he could have returned at any moment. And so years go by and he still hasn't returned. Well, you might start to become worried, and some did. Well, maybe he's not going to come back. Well, what about those of my family who died, who were Christians? What about them? I mean, if they're not alive when he comes back, maybe they're going to get left out. Well, Paul says, don't worry about that. I don't want you to have concern about that. Because when Jesus comes back, verse 15, for this we declare to you by word from the Lord, that those that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. So he's confirming them the idea that when Jesus comes back, when he's revealed from heaven, he's coming back to claim all of those who are his. The dead will rise first out of the graves. And if he were to come back in our lifetime and we were to be alive on the earth, we would wait for them to arise and then we would follow them up to be with Jesus. And so he gives us kind of an order of the resurrection here. All right, so... before we do that, I don't have this scripture up there, and I meant to. Let's see. So, Matthew chapter 25, I want to add this one. It's not up here, but let's look at Matthew 25. Again, he's discussing the second coming. And if we go to verse 31, he gives us a picture of what that day will look like, what we will see. He says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. So you have the image here. Jesus has returned. He is revealed in the clouds. Paul also gives us this picture in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, when Jesus comes with his mighty angels, right? And he's there in the clouds. Notice this, verse 32. Before him will be gathered all the nations. And you think about that, that implication is that all people, it's not going to be some secret thing that takes place over here out of the way where people can't see him. It's not some secret covert Navy SEALs mission. This is open to all because all will be gathered before him. And it's at that point he will then begin to separate people. And so, again, when Jesus comes, it's going to be one of those days you will not miss it. You're not going to be able to avoid it. You're not accidentally going to miss him coming through. I remember a couple years ago, there was a cult, and I don't remember their name. I don't know, maybe it might have been the Davidic cult in Texas, but one of them recently believed that they had been taught this idea that they were going to, there's a comet coming through and it was going to come and take some of them up, right? And they were, so many of them were nervous they were going to miss it, right? They weren't going to get on the comet. Well, here's the thing. None of them got on the comet. It went by and it kept on going and it waved as it went, but it didn't get anybody. When Jesus comes, we're not going to miss it. Now, whether or not we're prepared for it, that's on us. But when he comes back, all will see him. All eyes will have this unveiling of Jesus. And so, everyone will take part in this, whether you're on the right or on the left. Number three, there will be a separation that will take place. Now, the Bible gives us some descriptive terminology for this. Exactly how this is going to happen, we have to realize he's speaking symbolically a little bit here. But again, if we go back to Matthew 25 and continue looking here, he goes on in verse 32. All nations will be gathered before him, and what will he do? He will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates sheep from goats. And so he goes on to talk about this separation that will occur, this time when Jesus will show us his determination of the condition of our soul, whether we're in Christ or out of Christ. And those who are in Christ will be parted on the right, those who are outside of Christ will be parted to the left. Again, do we really think there's going to be like this great, like the Red Sea parting with Moses, where he's just going to come through and say, I don't know that's necessarily the case. But the point is, there's going to be a demarcation between the righteous and the unrighteous, and it will be revealed by God in that moment. And so, and in that moment, God is placing his judgment on our actions and our activities. And as we noted this morning, those who have done what's right, they will be parted to the right. And he will say, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And so it's at that point that the righteous will have their reward given to them. They will enter into this eternal home with God. Those who are on the left, those who are unrighteous, which, biblically speaking, is the vast majority of people. Matthew chapter 7, 13 and 14 tells us that many will fall in the path of destruction. And at this moment, they will then receive their reward as well. And so again, this day is going to both be a glorious day for those who are prepared. For those who are left unprepared, it will be a horrific day, a day that will be terrible to behold. And so we will see the separation. And so God will in separating the people, will reveal his judgment. And it's at that point that you and I will be judged, righteous or unrighteous. As Jesus stands in the clouds, he will call up those who have been prepared. Let's go to Revelation chapter 20. Again, let me say at the outset here that, of course, he's going to use a lot of symbolic language. And the symbolic language is used in order to teach deeper truths. And they're used in such a way to hide the meaning from those who were not supposed to hear it. The Romans, it was something that was hidden from the Roman government. There's a lot more in that. We can do that in a study of Revelation. So let's go to chapter 20. As he gets to the end of his writing, John begins to speak about some of the things that will take place at the end of time. Now, what's fascinating about Revelation, the vast majority of what's written has already occurred. Most of the things before chapter 20 have already taken place. They've already been fulfilled. That's something that you and I, in terms of prediction of the future, don't have to worry about. But now as we get to the end of the book, he then begins to reveal some things that will take place at the end of time. Chapter 20, he gets into that. If you go to chapter 20, and as John is seeing this vision, he begins to see a vision about the dragon. Now, if you go all the way back to Revelation 12, we were introduced to the dragon. Now, the dragon, he tells us, as he continues, is Satan. And so, when he talks about the dragon, you can just fill in Satan there. He's referring to Satan. And as he talks about the attributes of the dragon, he's referring to things about Satan himself. So he spends the first part of chapter 20 talking about the judgment on Satan. Now, back in Matthew 25, when God punished those who were to go to eternal punishment, notice real quickly, Matthew 25, 41. It's an important point. Matthew 25, 41. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you cursed, all right, those who've been condemned, into eternal fire, notice this, prepared for the devil and his angels. Now, we need to realize that hell was never built for us. Its intention was never for us. Now, we put ourselves in a condition to have to suffer that. But God's intention with hell was always as a punishment toward Satan, the devil, the evil one, the adversary. That was his destination, along with those who would follow his path. And unfortunately, human beings have gotten caught up in that because of their sin. And so, if we come back to Revelation 20 and notice what's going on here, there's some of this I don't want to talk about in this study in particular because it needs a lot more explanation. But if we go down to verse 10, if you go to verse 10, John writes, "And the devil who had deceived them," what does Jesus say? He was a liar from the beginning. He's the father of lies. He was a murderer from the beginning, right? He's the father of lies. He's the deceiver. "The devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the fallen prophet were. They were tormented day and night." Now notice this, and you might want to underline it. "Forever and ever." How long is hell going to last? Just as long as heaven's going to last. You know, sometimes people want to say that hell's this temporary place, or they just for whatever reason don't want to believe it's eternal. But do you realize the same descriptors for hell are used for heaven? And so if we limit what God says about hell as punishment, we also then have to limit what God says about heaven. And you see how that doesn't make logical sense? But he says it's forever and ever. And so that as we get into the day of judgment, one of the things that's going to occur, the very first thing, according to Revelation 20 and other passages, is Satan himself will be punished first. All right, so that's what we see first. And then as we continue to read, again, here I have the scripture up here, that he will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And again, this false idea about Satan, that he in some way is the Lord of hell. He's not. Satan is going to be suffering right along with everybody else there and just as severely. And so he is no Lord. He is no king. He will be punished along with the rest. So we go on down to verse 11. I want you to continue reading through verse 15 with me. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. Place for who? Any who did evil. They could not escape the gaze of Christ. I think about Hebrews 4, verse 12. For the word of God is living and active. It has the ability to pierce between soul and spirit. It is a discerner of the thoughts of men. None of us are hidden from his face. Right? Jesus, none of us can hide from him. There will be no place hidden where we will be able to hide from him. And then he goes on, he says, and I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God. Doesn't that sound like Matthew 25, right? Or Matthew 24, sorry. Matthew 24. I have to look back. It's one of those texts with it. I think it's Matthew 25, 31, sorry. But where all will stand before him, both the great and the small. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. You see him emphasizing that idea of we will be judged based upon our own actions. Whether we have followed the will of God or we have went against it, we've rebelled against it, we'll be judged according to our own activities. And then he says, death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And so after Satan receives his judgment, then God will turn his attention on the rest of us. Remember Matthew, Jesus said they're parted right and left. That separation that occurred, well, that's what he's talking about here. That separation between those who are in Christ and those who are outside. You don't want to be outside of Christ. Again, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 8, Paul says Jesus will, when he's revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, in flaming fire, bringing vengeance on those who do not know God, and not those who have not obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so you have this process where those who are alive at the time will wait for those who passed on. The souls of all who've died on land or at sea will be given up to judgment. And it's at that point we are judged. We will receive our reward. And I think it's interesting, in John's writing, he first deals with the judgment of those who have done evil. Right, that's chapter 20. God deals with all that before he ever comes back to those who are righteous. But it's at that point in chapter 21 that John says those who are righteous, those who are in Christ, will then receive their reward, as he mentions in Matthew 25. If we go to chapter 21, and we just look there at the text, verse 1 says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more." Again, there's, and I can't deal with all of them, but there's lots of false doctrine about the end time. One of them is about this idea of a renovated earth. Well, that's not the picture of Revelation 21, nor is it the picture that we read about in Peter's writing. He also says, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth." There's not going to be a revised. God's not going to be like these home do-over people who come into your home and fix it up and everything, make it look all great again. Right? It's not that kind of deal. He's going to completely destroy what's here now, and he will establish a new, seemingly, universe for us to exist in. What I also find interesting is he doesn't explain what that will be. Now, if you go to 1 Corinthians 15, I don't have this up on the board. Again, there's a lot of writing about this, so kind of have to move around. But 1 Corinthians 15, Paul speaks about the resurrection. And he mentions there in chapter 15 how that in the resurrection that we will be changed physically in the twinkling of an eye, in the snap of a moment, we will be reformed into something new. Now, exactly what that is, I don't think Paul really has the words to describe that because we don't have the symbolic understanding of what that would even be. But it does point to this idea that in the resurrection, and I'm talking about the final resurrection, God is going to bestow upon us glorious new bodies and place us in a glorious new, if you will, Garden of Eden. And so if we go back to Revelation 21, as we continue to read there, he said that he had seen the first heaven, the first earth had passed away. They are no more, as well as the sea. And then verse 2, "I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband." Now, the Jews, in their mindset, when they saw the Messiah, they saw this conquering king in the same image or likeness as David. And so, even at the end of Jesus' life, they were accusing him, or they were trying to make the accusation, that he in some way was going to transplant or lead a rebellion against Rome and against the Roman emperor, which wasn't true. You remember Pilate's question? He says, "Are you a king?" And Jesus, what's his response? He says, "You're right in saying I'm a king." And I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but he says, "But I'm not a king in the way you think about it. Because if I were, my servants would rise up and they wouldn't let you hold on to me. They would fight you. But Jesus' kingdom is a spiritual kingdom." And if the Jews were to, would have looked in the right place, thought about it in the correct way, they would have seen Jesus as a king, as he was, but as a king of a spiritual kingdom. And so when Jesus returns, and after judgment's been placed, he then will sit on his throne as king, and all will bow before him. He goes on here to say that, and I love verse 3 here, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God.'" And that idea, it's as though John, and this is probably the case, is drawing from the image of the temple, where the Ark of the Covenant was, where the mercy seat was, where the presence of God dwelt. That same presence of God that led the Israelites through their wilderness wanderings, who was there by a pillar of by a cloudy pillar by day and by a fiery tower, if I can say that word, by night. Right? And John uses that imagery and he says, "But God will dwell with them." So much of this, also draws from the Garden of Eden. Think about what Adam and Eve had at the very beginning. They had close communion with God every day. They had no kind of restrictions, no kind of encumbrance with them, between them and God. They were able to commune with Him in a very personal way without any kind of thought of sin and of guilt and all the things that come along with it. And so in so much of this, it's a restoration of that idea, of the idea of Eden. And so it is on that day after Jesus has been revealed in a sudden moment, after the separation has occurred and judgment has been placed, those who have done evil to hell, those who have done righteously to heaven, Jesus will then sit on His throne. And we will bask in His glory. It's going to be an awesome day for those who are prepared. You ever worked really hard for something in your life? If you haven't, you will sometime. There'll be something in your life that you're going to want really bad. But it's going to require something of you. You're going to have to invest something of yourself in it. And it may take you time, and you may have to sweat. It may cost you money, too. And you're going to have to put up a little bit of sacrifice. But when you get to the end of that, and you finally receive that which you have been grasping for, there's no better feeling in all the world than the achievement of knowing I've worked hard, I've sacrificed, I've done what was necessary, and now I can bask in the blessings of achievement, of gaining something. Right now, our boys are working on learning 100 verses. And one of us is struggling a whole lot. But he's making it through. And he's got to be pushed. At the end of this, he's going to know these. And at the end, he's going to know he's achieved something. And that's what we try to teach our children. That's what we try to learn ourselves. Is there's a purpose behind it. God is trying to teach us something. He's trying to teach us something about cost. Things cost something. Nothing's for free. Somebody paid for that. He's trying to teach us about sacrifice and what it means to truly give all you have. He's trying to teach us about reward at the end of that journey. Earlier in the book, John writes from the words of Jesus, "Those who overcome, they will be given a crown of life." And he's not talking about, it's interesting, in the book of Revelation, there are two crowns talked about. Do you know that? There's the Stephanos crown, and then there's the crown of rule or authority. Within the whole book of Revelation, people either wear the Stephanos crown of achievement, of victory, or they wear the crown of authority. He talks about the saints. The saints are going to be given the crown of victory if they remain faithful. And he talks about the martyrs underneath the altar. They've been given the crown of victory already. And then there are those who are talked about in a negative way, those evil rulers who've been given crowns of authority, and they inflict their power on others. It's interesting, only one individual in the book of Revelation receives both crowns. And that's Jesus, that's our Lord. He's both a victor and a king. He showed us the pathway to heaven. Will we follow? This evening, as you think about your life and where you are you prepared? Are you prepared for that great day? It's coming. Will we be prepared for it? It will come suddenly, and so we must stay on alert. Are you ready? If you're not, we invite you, we encourage you to get things corrected this very evening. If we can help you become a Christian, we'd love to help you do that. If you've got sin in your life that you need to do some repenting of, we're here to help you with that. We're here to support and love one another. If we can help in any way, please come as together we stand and as we sing.
Those that need to take the Lord's Supper. I don't see any hands. All righty. Got a good group here tonight. Everybody be careful going home. It might still be a little bit raining and foggy. So pray that everybody gets home safely. May we pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day that we've had to come worship you. Father, many of us are blessed with good health that allows us to be here this day. We pray for those who might be sick or afflicted. We know that we have several and pray that you will be with them and be with the doctors that are ministering to them and to their families. Pray during this time, Father, that all will look to you. Father, each of us are blessed spiritually and materially. Let us be reminded that those blessings come to us through you. Father, as we go to our homes now, we pray that you'll keep us safe until the next appointed time that we meet back together. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.